a drastic weather change is coming here. This morning it is cold. It's supposed to be a storm front rolling in tonight. Gonna get some rain. Temperature's gonna drop way down, and it's, you know, complete shift from what it was just a day ago. Today's like a transitional day. We're in a transitional month, October 2012. There's an election coming up, of course, and if you wonder why don't I talk about politics, because we have something much, much better to talk about. That's why. And since we can talk about it, we should. Most in the world cannot talk about these subjects, so they talk about politics, you know. But if you'll find that if you can talk about these truly relevant issues, then politics is just, you don't want to waste your time. Now, do we have free will? Let's say we go to sleep and we're dreaming. Like last night, I had many dreams, I always do, and a lot of the dreams are like there's this overwhelming situation of trying to like imprison me, and I'm able to, and I'm fleeing it, and it's a tremendous, you know, effort to flee in many different ways, and I end up getting to a place of safety. Again, last night, same thing, amazing. Now, does a figure in a dream have free will? When you go to sleep and you're dreaming, do those dream figures in the dream, do they have free will? Or are they simply like cartoonish-like images acting out what the dreamer wants them to act out? You see? And the question, do these body minds have free will, or are the are body minds simply cartoonish-like figures acting out what the someone else wants them to do, what belief wants them to do? That is the question, isn't it? The truth is that what we truly are has never incarnated. Is not incarnated now, has never been incarnated, has never been born. But our true identity, the I am presence of isness, which is perfectly included in perfect inclusiveness, has never incarnated, has never, when we dream, go to sleep and dream, and we have these stick figures, these cartoon figures running around doing all this stuff in a dream, is the dreamer in the dream? Is the dreamer actually in the dream? Well, the answer is, you would have to say, you know, probably not really in the dream. Not really. Not really in the dream. Same with what we truly are. We are not, we have never incarnated. The self, the true self, what we truly are, our true identity, has never been born. Has never died, has never gone through anything in existence, has never been in existence at all, is not in existence right now either. And this is more relevant than politics. No matter who wins an election, the truth still remains true that we are not in existence at all. These dream body mind figures that are running around campaigning and getting elected and governing and being governed and all this stuff, those are just puppets. They don't have any free will. They're being manipulated by belief. There is no there. There is no identity there at all. But belief believes there's an identity there, because belief wants to believe that it's the prime creator and that it is the one that is in charge. It wants to be in charge of identity. So belief believes that these body minds have some true identity instead of just a name and you know, a false, phony sense of identity. There is no identity in a real identity in a dream. No real identity in a dream. There's a fake identity. Okay, but that's comes from belief. It's simply belief believes there's an identity there. Belief believes there's free will. Belief believes that. But belief is the one orchestrating everything in this dream. Belief is the dreamer of the dream of existence. our responsibility here, when I say our responsibility, the dreamer of the dream's responsibility, which is spirit, we're really spirit. I am presence of isness. We are spirit. The responsibility of spirit is to recognize, ultimately is to awaken from the dream and realize that we've never been in the dream. But more to the point right now, let's see if I can catch the thread of that. We need to recognize the scope of belief, the full scope of belief. You know, we have a little belief, we keep expanding and realizing, my gosh, this belief system has this enormous scope to it. Enormous scope to it. And the reason why we keep sleeping, dreaming, and actually believing, desiring for belief to be true, is we don't recognize the scope of belief and how it it's a complete belief system that believes it is the authority, it is the true authority over us, over the dreamer, the one who's doing the dreaming. Belief believes it's the authority over the dreamer. Or at the very least, belief believes there's a reciprocal relationship. And let's look at reciprocal relationships, okay? A parent gives birth to the child. The child doesn't give birth to the parents, so there's not a reciprocal relationship there. The children can grow up and give birth to other children, okay, and do what their parents did, okay, have children, but they cannot give birth to their parents. Just the same way that spirit does not have a reciprocal relationship with the prime creator, because the prime creator expanded itself, and that expansion, that inclusiveness, we call it spirit. Spirit is one with that expansion. But spirit did not expand itself to give rise to prime creator. You see, it's not reciprocal. Spirit can expand and create like the prime creator, endless expansion, seamless expansion. So it can create as the prime creator creates. So spirit is co-creator, but spirit cannot give rise to prime creator. You see, it's not a reciprocal relationship. Now, let's take it a little further. Can truth and lies, is there a reciprocal relationship there? Can certainty and belief have a reciprocal relationship? So can lies give rise to truth? You see, or can truth give rise to lies? No, there isn't. Not only is there no reciprocal relationship, there's no relationship at all. But belief is trying to have a reciprocal relationship. It's saying that the dreamer and the dream have a reciprocal relationship, that the dreamer is giving rise to the dream and the dream is giving rise to the dreamer. That is insanity. Belief is insanity. You need to see the full scope of insanity. It's, you know, way out here. The full scope. Belief believes it's giving rise to the dreamer just as much as the dreamer is giving rise to the dream. So it tries to stymie the awakening, the realization of our true identity by insisting that there's this reciprocal relationship. It will say, yes, the dreamer does give rise to the dream, but the dream also gives rise to the dreamer. Just like cause give rise to effects, and the effects do complete the cause, they give witness to the cause, but they're not causing the cause. They're not giving rise to the cause. So belief has this mistake, very much a mistake. We need to see the scope of the mistake, the scope of the madness, the scope of the insanity, to see just how fundamental and basic this mistake is, this false premise is of belief. And we need to realize you cannot bring lies cannot bring truth into lies and have this reciprocal relationship with truth. belief will always be false. It will always be mistaken. It arises from a false premise. It cannot bring truth in to lies and create this integral, reciprocal relationship. And that's what belief is trying to do. That is why you have so much teaching in the world that seems to be off target. Because it comes from belief. See, belief believes it can do anything. The premise of belief is that spirit can change reality. That gives rise to belief, because spirit can't change reality. So if it wants to change reality, what happens? Desire to change it is there, and that desire to change it gives rise to belief that it can be done. When? Right now? No. In the future. In the future, which gives rise to the notion of time. Reality doesn't need time. Reality is what it is right now. It's always been that. It doesn't need a past, and it doesn't need a future. And if you're engaged in a process of doing something, you're going to have a past and you're going to have a future. Reality has no need for time whatsoever. So when spirit has this desire to be prime creator, and that means to change reality, that desire gives rise to the belief that it is possible. So belief, from its very inception, is this desire to change reality, and belief serves that desire. So it believes that reality can be changed, and that nothing, therefore, is immutable. Everything is changeable. There are no facts. There is no reality except change. That's what belief believes in. There is no reality. Change is reality. And you know that you in this world, that's what you get fed, that the only reality is change. This is entirely belief. Reality is immutable. It is unchangeable. It is set. The way reality is unchangeable. And yet here we are, or at least what we think we are, what we believe ourselves to be, what belief believes us to be, in this make-believe world of existence where the only constant seems to be change. It comes from the belief that reality can be changed. It comes from the desire to change reality. See, belief is secondary to desire. First came spirit wanting to be prime creator, to experience being prime creator. And since that cannot be experienced, it gives rise to what's called desire, which means desire means you want to do something, but you haven't done it yet. Okay, you desire, you want something, you don't have it yet. You have a desire for it. See, in reality, there's no such thing as desire. Desire doesn't arise, because everything we choose to experience is instantaneously, directly, spontaneously experienced. There's no gap, no gaps in reality whatsoever, none. But when we want to change reality, it cannot be changed, so that it gives rise to this sense of a gap. And that gap is felt as desire for something to happen, something to be experienced. Okay? From that desire to change reality springs a belief system of how this can be accomplished, to fulfill the desire. And that's called belief, a belief system. And this belief system is all about how to accomplish the impossible. And that is what this dream has been all about from the very beginning. Not at some point. It didn't change at some point into the way that it is. It was this. It's been this way since the very inception, since the instant that spirit wanted to be prime creator. The desire and belief system arose. It's been that way from that very instant, and it's been the same ever since. It's never changed. But belief believes it can change itself. Belief believes there's nothing immutable, so it insists that it can transform, metamorphosize itself, enlighten itself, transcend itself. It cannot. It cannot. Real self-realization comes when we realize that beliefs cannot be enlightened, cannot transcend itself, cannot metamorphosize, cannot evolve into something different than what it is. It's futile. It's a futile quest. And then when we drop that quest, say it's impossible, then we're at peace, we're resting with what we are. We're abiding in what we are. We're no longer trying to change what we are. So most of the efforts towards enlightenment are to enlighten belief, because belief believes it can enlighten itself. That is not true. It cannot change itself. Again, belief is the belief that everything can be changed. There's nothing immutable. But a cause and its effect are immutable, as far as they cannot be separated. The purpose, the cause and the purpose that the effects serve cannot be separated. Belief believes it can change its purpose. It cannot change its purpose. So belief cultivates this idea of change to the point where it even says it can transcend itself. It can transcend its purpose that it serves. No. Just like spirit cannot transcend the creator that it is one with. Okay? Belief cannot transcend the idea that it is one with. Only by choosing a new idea, spirit choosing a new idea, does a situation resolve, as it must in reality. Okay. So spirit, it is belief that is the engine that is driving this effort towards enlightenment, towards transcendence, towards evolution, towards change, towards higher consciousness, all this stuff, that is just belief that is doing that. Because belief is saying that it doesn't need our true identity. It doesn't need self-realization. I am presence of isness realization. No, belief says, no, I'm going to give you something better. I'm going to do something transcendent. I'm going to be enlightened. Enlightened belief. Where peddles that. Belief peddles enlightened belief to us as if that's our goal. It is not our goal at all. Enlightenment is not our goal. Enlightened belief is not our goal. Enlightened transcendent belief is not our goal. Okay? At all. Our goal is to realize that can never happen. Belief is what it is. It's a belief that nothing is permanent. Nothing is certain. Nothing is immutable. It's a denial of reality. So how can you have an enlightened denial of reality? How can you have a transcendent denial of reality? How can an effect transcend its cause? How can an effect transcend its cause? It cannot. But belief believes that it can. So it just keeps suckering, just keeps this play going. And our desire for it to be true keeps us attached to it, keeps us engaged with it. And we need to disengage with it, say, ah, you know, that disengage, it can never be true. It can never happen. An enlightened belief is nonsense. Belief cannot choose a different purpose to serve. It's trying to serve itself, you know. It's trying to make itself the prime creator, as it were, and make us the children of belief. And they say, don't worry, you're going to be children of an enlightened belief. Remember, belief does not believe in reality at all. It's the denial of reality. It always will be the denial of reality. So you can have an enlightened denial of reality, a transcendent denial of reality. What does that matter? It's still exactly the same. It's a denial of reality. It's a denial of what we really are, of what truly is. So you can see this is more interesting than politics. Because you're seeing the scope of the situation, and you say, I think I see, you know, that it's going to be possible to disengage from this. It seems possible to disengage from this. And then, so that brings up like, yeah, this is what I really want. I want to disengage from this madness. It is madness. Belief is madness. This world existence is completely mad. I go out each day in investigations and observations and go through, you know, this and this place and on the internet through all this stuff and looking, observing carefully. And my gosh, this dream is completely mad. It is completely mad. It is just amazing, stupefying, you know, how completely insane it is. And the, by and large, the aspirations in this dream are simply to enlighten belief. That is the aspiration. That is the aspiration of the dream. Okay, but where does the aspiration to awaken come from? From the dreamer, not from the dream. The dream has its own aspirations, which is to have an enlightened dream. Enlightened belief. Okay, and everything in this dream is aspiring to enlightened belief, but the dreamer aspires to choose a different idea. Okay, because the dreamer realizes, whoa, you know, this dream is crazy. It thinks, it believes that the dreamer is a child of the dream, and it wants to replace, you know, the prime creator, and wants to replace reality, and it believes it can do it, and this is nuts. So that it's the dreamer that wants to replace the dream with another idea, okay? That's where the aspiration comes from. It does not come from the dream. It does not come from belief, the aspiration to set the dream down, to set belief down, to set the desire down, to set the idea of wanting to be prime creator, set that down and choose the idea of not wanting to be prime creator, which gives rise to no desire, okay? No desire there, because that is experienceable, right? If you say, I don't want to be prime creator. That's an idea. I don't want to be prime. I want to let everything in reality, I want reality to be as it is. It already is as it is. So that's immediately experienceable. That will give rise to the effect, instead of a belief system, unconditional love, an overlay, instead of a belief system, an overlay that lets everything be exactly as it is. It's not trying to change anything. And it can even overlay the entire belief system. The entire belief system is overlaid by unconditional love, peace, unconditional peace, perfect peace, seamless peace, because we're not desiring that anything be different than what it is. And so the belief system is a belief system, right? That's what it is. We're not desiring that the belief system be something different. Because that's exactly what belief wants to do. It wants to change itself from a belief system into something else. No, that's madness. But unconditional love overlays the belief system and accepts it as it is, says this is a belief system based on, overlays the desires, this is its desire. This is the belief system that is serving this desire. And it doesn't try to change it at all. It just lets it be exactly as it is. Nothing has to be changed in the belief system. It just needs to be overlaid, which is why you see these ambassadors of certitude and reality come into the world, and they don't try to change anything in the world. They just radiate unconditional love and peace. And that's what they're showing us. The efforts to change in the dream are belief-based. They're belief-based, okay? Whereas choosing a different idea, desire not to be prime creator, does not try to change anything in the dream. It simply overlays it with unconditional love and says it is what it is. It is a belief system. No need to try and change it, right? Reality is not threatened by a belief system. It is belief that is trying to change belief. It is not reality that's trying to change belief. Reality is not in a war with belief. It believes, how can reality be in a war with nothing? With an idle, whimsical idea that has no effects, real effects whatsoever. There's no war. It's beliefs in a war with itself. All these wars that come up in turmoil, it's belief doing all that. Belief is in a war with itself. It's trying to change itself. It's trying to metamorphosize itself. It's trying to enlighten itself. It's trying to be something other than what it is, right? Because it comes from the desire for spirit to be something other than what it is. Spirit wants to be other than what it is. It wants to be prime creator. So belief serves this purpose. So belief believes it's possible for everything to become something other than what they are. So belief is trying to change itself, you know. It's trying to also develop a threat, a way to be able to destroy reality too. But it also has this desire to enlighten itself, to change itself. And so it sponsors all these spirituality, which is simply an effort of belief to enlighten itself. I'm going to boost the gain here a little bit. Okay. Aspiration to choose a new idea comes from spirit. It doesn't come from the dream. So therein lies the key to the situation. We keep waiting for belief to become something different than what it is. It cannot. But belief can never accept this. Okay, this is the crucial point. Belief will never believe that it cannot become something other than what it is. Will never. It's incapable of it. Because it serves the purpose, the idea of wanting reality to become something different than what it is. And so belief has to serve that purpose. Therefore, it can never transcend the purpose it serves. So it will always believe it can become something different than what it is. So that is exactly what needs to be set down, the belief that something can become different than what it is. It's not true. Belief is the effort to become different than what it is. And that effort cannot become different than what it is. That's what it is. The effort to become different than what it is what it is. If ever to try and force reality to change, become different than what it is, that is what belief is. And belief is simply trying to gain that power. It's trying to gain that power. That is what it is. It can't change. It cannot change. The very fact that belief can never accept itself as what it is. It's always trying to transmute, transform, change, enlighten, metamorphosize itself. It's always working on this. It's always in this ferment, this of change, hope and change. It cannot. It always will be that. It always will be that. It can never be in peace. Jesus said, in this kingdom of belief, there's no place for the Son of God to lay their head, you know. No place. There's no place, right? Because this belief is this constant effort to change what it is. Cannot change what it is. It is the effort to change what it is. That is what it is. So the aspiration, the clarity to see this doesn't come from belief. It comes from spirit. What we truly are, our true identity, is tired of this game, you know, tired of this, and wants to get on with experiencing another idea. It wants to get on with that, because this game that it's playing is just terrible. It's unfulfilling. It's unsatisfying. It doesn't lead anywhere. It feels like we're just getting nowhere. Like we're treading water. We're stuck in spinning our wheels in sand, which is exactly true. That is what we're doing. That is exactly what we're doing. We're not getting anywhere. And yet belief will never believe that. It says, no, we're changing everything. You see, belief wants to change everything. It wants to change what it is. And so, of course, existence is constant change. And of course, you run across times where there's going to be massive change. And there will be massive change coming in this world. Belief wants to prove that it can change everything. That can even change what it is, the purpose that it serves. Because the purpose that it serves is a desire to change everything, to change reality. So belief has no choice but to try and prove that it can change everything. So if you ask, are there changes coming in the world? Of course there are changes coming in the world. Belief is always changing whatever it can change, and it sets up this change ahead of time. Remember, belief is in control. The kingdom of belief, it's belief that's in control. It's the idea, of course, that is really truly in control, and it's spirit choosing the idea that's truly in control. But once spirit chooses an idea, then that idea plays out. Okay, and the belief system is the effects of this playing out. And as this plays out, it sets up situations to be changed. Remember, you cannot change unless you have something first set up that to change. You know, if you want to change the configuration of a house, first you have to have the house. If you want to remodel it, first you have to have a house there. So let's say you have a desire to extensive remodeling of a house. First you have to build a house, and then you have the house, and you say, okay, now I can go about really remodeling this house. It's like that. So first belief builds up this civilization, this builds up a world, builds up a civilization, 7 billion people on the planet, and then it says, okay, great, now I can go about changing all of this. That's what it does. That is how this dream plays out. This is the play of belief. The dance of Maya, as some call it. Dance of duality. The dance of remodeling. Dance of changing. There's a huge remodeling coming up. And when you remodel, there's two ways to remodel. One is, it's called a live-in remodel, where, let's say you're remodeling a kitchen and a dining room or something, okay? The people can still live in the house. They live in their bedroom. They set up a temporary kitchen, electric, some kind of, you know, plug-in hot plates and stuff, and they can live there in the house as you do the remodeling. And once you finish remodeling, then they move back into the kitchen and have full use of the house. That's a live-in remodel. The second remodel is when the people move out of the house. They rent an apartment or a house, condo, and they stay there for however long the remodel takes place. You do a total remodel the whole house extensively, and then once you're done, they move back in. So there's those two types of remodels. There's a third type of remodel where, let's say, you're remodeling the kitchen and the dining room, and they live there, and then you're going to remodel the bedrooms. And what they do is then they set up like a temporary bedroom in the dining room or something, and then you remodel the rest of the house. So there is that kind of shuffling around in the house, which is pretty uncommon, really. It's very uncomfortable. So the purpose of belief, this belief system, is the continuous remodel. Whatever arises, it builds stuff, change, constant change, trying to change the very purpose that it serves. Change its very purpose. So it attempts to do this by just building models and then changing the model, building up and then changing what has been built up extensively. So sometimes there's a live-in remodel, sometimes there's a move remodel, or you have to move out. And the remodeling that is coming on this planet could very well be a move-out remodel. Okay, that's what I've seen. I cannot be 100% sure that this is accurate, but what I've seen is it's a move-out remodel where the remodeling of this planet will be so extensive that you won't even be able to dwell here. These dream body-mind dream figures will not even be able to dwell here during this remodel. There's also remodels where you stay in the house for a while, and then you move out for a shorter period of time. Let's say you don't have the money, you don't want to spend the money to move out for a year. So you live in the house for 6 months while they do some of the remodel, and then for the bedroom remodel, you move out. That's another type of remodel. And it could be that way with this change that's coming up in the world. Is that we could shift someplace here for a while and then go to, you know, another place while the remodel is being carried out here. But the business of existence is change. It is remodeling. That is the business. It's trying to change the purpose that it serves, but ultimately it's trying to build up and manufacture the power to change reality. The power to change reality. And all this changing, remodeling, is the effort to build up that power. The power to threaten reality with change and force the Prime Creator to change reality for Spirit and to make Spirit Prime Creator. So the question is, what kind of remodel is coming in this world? Many of us have seen an extensive remodel. You know, the ancient prophecies have said extensive is coming. Some say that it's the most extensive remodel ever on this planet. The most. And it's a relocation remodel is what many have said. Could very well be. These dreams that I have, it's like I'm going, you know, to some safe area, some safe place while this turmoil is taking place here. So these videos are serving a wide purpose. One is to see what self-realization is really about and distinguish it from the false spirituality of belief. The other is to recognize what the agenda of belief has to be, even though belief tells you that it can change the agenda that it serves, it cannot. The other, and then by realizing the agenda that belief serves, that the purpose that it serves must serve, you then can get a feel for what may be coming up and maybe how drastic it might be and what the options are, okay, coming up. So it's serving a wide, total, complete purpose here, these videos. It's not just, you know, just one thing, you know, self-realization. Yes, it's serving that purpose. But also, practically, it's also recognizing, you know, what is going on in the dream, what is going to go on in the dream. Not that it matters to reality, but to the one who is dreaming, that it matters. Because if the dreamer... It doesn't become wise about the dream and recognize, wait a minute, I'm not a child of this dream. Then it can keep engaged with this desire, with this dream. It can be re-engaged more and more and more, which it does not serve the purpose of awakening from the dream, or choosing a different idea. So we have to be wise about this situation, really wise about it. It could be a relocation remodel, and I'm just giving you the tools to work with here. I'm giving you the tools, some language to work with. It could be a relocation remodel, okay? Let's look at it this way, a live-in remodel or a relocation remodel, okay? And we know that belief is always remodeling, always changing, and we could have a minor live-in remodel. Or it could be a major relocation remodel. I'm trending towards relocation remodel, but that is not, you know, it is not set in stone. But you, just so you have this in your mind, and you can now work with these tools, and you can look at the situation, look at your own guidance, look at your own insights, look at your own awareness, and then you have these kind of tools to assess it, you know. You see, these changes are coming. Is it going to be a live-in remodel? We'll be able to, you know, will it be a live-in sort of shuffle-around remodel, where we kind of shuffle around as it gets remodeled, go from place to place kind of during the remodel? Or will it just be a basic remodel where we just can stay where we are and everything? Will it be a minor remodel? You know, is it a matter of putting in a new vanity and a new sink? You know, is it just like a bathroom remodel? Is that all it is? Or is it a, you know, kitchen remodel, or, you know, a large remodel? Or is it just a knockdown, build a new house remodel? You know, complete knockdown. A knockdown remodel, you bring in the bulldozers, okay? and sometimes you knock down the foundation, and sometimes you leave part of the foundation, you know. Sometimes the entire, you know, it's called a knockdown, complete knockdown, where you just flatten. You have the lot, the house is gone within 2 days. You can just knock the whole thing down, put it in trucks, gone. And then you know, start grading the lot, and regrade it and everything. And then you start redigging a new foundation. That's a complete knockdown. So some say that the change that's coming is a complete knockdown, new house, complete knockdown remodel. Very possibly it will be that. Complete knockdown remodel. So relocation is, in that case, is relevant, right? It's very relevant. So we have the full scope here. Full scope. We talk about what is really self-realization and what is faux realization, that is belief-based realization. We talk about choosing a new idea, which is what ultimately must be done. The dreamer must choose a new idea to experience. It cannot have this idea of want, the desiring to change reality and experience something other than instability and change. It cannot. It has to choose a new idea. It has to choose a different causal agent. There's no way around that. But we can go towards that, and aim towards that. So we cover that, and we cover this confusion with belief insisting that it can change the purpose that it serves, which is why we keep kowtowing to belief and keep marveling at belief, keep believing in belief. You know, like, wow, belief has so much belief in itself. You know, it's like we're cheerleaders. We're saying, belief is so amazing. It keeps believing that it can change what the purpose that it serves. It can change what it is. And we say, wow, isn't that amazing? The belief can accomplish the impossible. We desire that. We're desiring to accomplish the impossible, and we're like watching. It's like we're watching a movie, and we're desiring an outcome to take place in the movie. And yet, no matter what outcome takes place in the movie, it is still just a movie. You see, that's very much like what we're doing. Imagine that we're watching a movie, and we're cheerleading. We're saying, "Yeah, you know, we want this to happen in the movie." And the heroes and the heroines are and the villains are all moving around the movie. And we're desiring an outcome. And then in the movie, there's this outcome, you know, and there's love forevermore, happiness nevermore. And we're saying, ah, we did it, you know, we did it, the movie did it. But we forget that it is simply just a movie. It's not real. It's just a movie. So there's no real outcome at all taking place in the movie. We forget that. So here we are cheerleading existence, you know, like where spirit is watching this movie. And real excited, like, here comes a remodel. This is fabulous. You know, this incredible remodel is coming. And it's being done by belief. And belief is this hero. And belief is going to do the impossible. And it still believes it can do it. Isn't that great? And we're so proud of our, of our offspring, of our quote-unquote creation, belief. That belief is still so plucky that it still believes that it can change what it is. You know, it's just a movie. And so whatever outcome happens in the movie, that is not real at all. Just a waste of time. We're just engaging with this movie, this dance of belief. We're just engaging with it, and we're enthralled by it because we think it's our baby, you know? It's like our child. Belief is our child. And we're, you know, just like a parent so proud of the child, and we ask belief, you know, can you believe you can still do it? And belief says, you know, yes, my parent, you know, I still believe, I know, I totally believe I'm going to do it. And I know how to do it, and I've set all this stuff, civilization and 7 billion people on the planet, and I'm going to do it, and I'm going to, you know, change everything and transcend and enlighten and all this stuff. And we say, oh, what a child we have made here. What an incredible child we've made. It's like that. We have pride in this child of belief that we have, that has arisen from our desire to change reality. But it's not a true creation, because it has no real effects at all. It's simply a desire and a belief. It's not a knowing. It's not at all. And yet we do have this pride in it. And we're so proud, you know, that like we want to see what belief can do. It's like a parent wanting to see a child. What can a child do, you know? And the child builds, you know, stuff out of blocks. And the parent says, oh, the child is so smart. This is incredible. This child is going to grow up to be a genius. We feel that way about belief, that belief is going to grow up to transcend itself. That is what we are waiting for belief to transcend itself. And we watch and we're saying, wow, belief seems to have this, it's incredibly smart. It has this way that it's going to transcend itself. And we're waiting for that transcendence to happen. But it's just whatever happens, it's just a movie. You can have a movie, and some figure in the movie, some hero, heroine in the movie, can reach enlightenment, transcendence in the movie. They're just actors and actresses. It's worthless. It's no real transcendence. It's just actors and actresses in a movie acting like they've enlightened, that they've gotten enlightened, transcendence, enlightenment, etc. There's nothing there. Nothing real there. Spirit is still spirit. Reality is still reality. What is reality? What does reality have any need for transcendence? Does reality have any need for enlightenment? What is this talk about enlightenment and transcendence then? It's only talk of belief. Spirit simply needs to realize what it already is. Doesn't need enlightenment, doesn't need transcendence, doesn't need evolution. Doesn't need growth of consciousness. It doesn't need spirituality. What does reality need spirituality for? It already is flawless and perfect. It is what it is. It doesn't need to be something different. What is reality? It is this perfect expansion, endless expansion. It already is expansion. It doesn't need to more expansion. It already is expansion. It doesn't need some higher degree of expansiveness. It already is perfect expansiveness from the very beginning. So, but belief believes it's going to give it some, make it more, make it better, make it, you know, it's going to transcend reality. No, reality doesn't need to be transcended. It doesn't need any transcendence. And so we keep seeing the scope of belief, you see. The scope of belief is this belief that it's going to transcend reality, that it's greater than endlessness. What is greater than endlessness? Nothing is greater than endlessness. And belief believes that there's nothing, that there's something that is nothing, and that this nothing is somehow greater than everything, that it's beyond endlessness. This is belief. This is spirituality. This is where belief goes for so-called transcendence or enlightenment. That's where belief goes. It's not where reality goes. Reality doesn't need any of that. It already is endlessness, endless expansiveness. There is no end to endlessness. There's nothing beyond endlessness. And belief just plays with words and concepts and says, well, if there's nothing, nothing is beyond endlessness. You know, there is this beyond endlessness, is there's this nothing, and that endlessness arises in this nothingness. that is the talk of belief. That is the spirituality of belief. Okay, it is completely insane. It is nuts. It's just belief. It's just a movie. It's a movie saying, well, you know, we went to the end of endlessness, and what did we find there? We found nothing there. And so beyond endlessness is this vast nothingness. And we found it, you know. that's a movie. Constant change. That this weather is going to be changed. It's going to be modified. It's going to be very cold. It's going to be very windy. It's going to be very stormy, very wet. It's going to be totally opposite of what it was just a day ago, which was tropical and balmy and blissful and fresh and beautiful. You know, it's just incredible. Now it's going to be remodeled, right? It's going to be remodeled. So it's super important to see the difference between the spirituality of belief and the truth of reality that already is, and choosing the overlay of the belief system. Overlays all spirituality of belief. Belief has this entire spirituality, you know. All this stuff, all the spirituality is belief-based. What we are doesn't need spirituality at all. It simply needs acceptance of what it is. And that's what belief will never give acceptance of what is. That's why it constantly is working on this spirituality to change what is. We got to improve. We got to develop. We can be better. We can be better. We can be better. That is belief. That is belief-based religion. It is belief-based spirituality. And it's nothing but a dream. It is nothing but a movie. And all these body minds are actors and actresses in a movie. And of course the actress or actor can be enlightened in a movie, can act enlightened, like they abide in nothingness or something, you know. That's just an actor or an actress. That's not real self-realization. That is not acceptance of what is. That is not the overlay of unconditional love. And when you come across a genuine ambassador of reality here, you realize, hey, whatever it is, that's different. Because they're simply abiding in this overlay. You ask them, you know, where do you want to go? Where's your desire? And they say, I have no desire for anything. Everything is already overlaid perfectly. Wherever I go, I am within that overlay, that perfect overlay. They're at bliss and at peace in all conditions, in all places, because they're experiencing the overlay of this belief system. And they're just allowing the belief system, accepting it as it is. Not trying to change it. Not trying to change it as it is. All this madness, all this stuff, they just laugh and say, you know, that's just the play of belief. But I am experiencing the overlay of that play of belief. I'm simply letting it be what it is, which is the only way. That is reality, that is truth. There is no other way to reconcile with truth, reality, as it were, but to simply accept what is. And this belief system is what it is. It is a belief system that believes it can change what it is. That's not a threat to reality. Don't have to stop it. We don't have to change it. We don't have to do something to it. Simply overlay it with unconditional love. The acceptance of what is gives rise to this overlay effect of overlays this entire belief system. All of it. All of it. All the spirituality of it. All this talk about nothingness, you know. There's nothing beyond endlessness is supposedly nothing. No experience at all. You know, that's belief. Belief says it can reach no experiencing at all. No, reality is perfect, endless experiencing, expansion of experiencing endlessly. There's no such thing as no experiencing. That's belief. Belief believes it can arrive at no experiencing, at nothing. So just overlay that. Don't need to change it. Don't need to do anything with that. Just accept that is what it is. That's belief. That is what belief is. It is constant belief it can transcend what it is, which is a servant of the desire to change reality. And the frustration comes because we keep looking for an outcome in the movie, you know. Or it doesn't matter what the outcome is in the movie. What we need to choose is a new idea, and then in looking at the screen, at the movie, we'll still see the movie, but it's like we put a screen protector over the screen, and that screen, we're experiencing the screen protector, where nothing is happening at all to the screen protector. All this play on the movie screen is not affecting the screen protector at all. You see, and the screen can even melt, you know, and the screen protector will not melt. The screen can burn up, and yet the screen protector, nothing will happen to the screen protector. So whatever happens in the movie doesn't concern us, because our experiencing is with the screen protector, the overlay of the screen. And yet our education, of which belief is the one that does all the educating here, you know, it insists that we're supposed to do something to the movie, that we're supposed to care about what happens in the movie. That is not true. We're supposed to choose a new idea and experience the overlay of this movie and not care at all about what's happening in the dream. As soon as we care about what's happening in the dream, we want to change what's happening in the dream, we are rejecting acceptance of what is. As soon as we're working for outcomes in the dream, in the movie, we are rejecting what is. We're trying to change. We're believing that we can change what is. That is that's relevant, that's important. As soon as we're attached to outcomes, then we are lost in the kingdom of belief. We have accepted its purpose of to change what is. So let the movie play out however it wants to play out. It doesn't concern us at all. It does not concern us at all. It only concerns those who are still desiring to change what is. Those who want to accept what is, which is reality, which is endless, perfect, flawless expansion of richness, of experiencing. We don't have to be concerned about the play of this movie of belief. We simply choose the overlay and accept it as it is, which is this attempt to change what it is. That's it. And of course we can, if there's a remodel, we can relocate. That can happen too. If that helps us in getting comfortable with not trying to change what is, then if that's helpful, it's pragmatic, that's not a problem. Again, reality is not threatened by anything. But our acceptance of what is fragile enough. We're in this fragile, you know, we're kind of reluctantly coming to it and saying, okay, I want to accept what is, but I'm kind of reluctant. That reluctance can be gravitating, you know, this way or that way. And so it is pragmatic and practical to accept this fact, to put ourselves in a position where we can gravitate towards it, accepting what is and not trying to change what is. And so it is relevant, relocation, whether it's a live-in remodel or a relocation remodel, that's relevant. These things are relevant to us. They're relevant from the standpoint of our fragility and our need to gravitate towards choosing a new idea and accepting what is and not re-engaging with trying to change what is. It's relevant. It is relevant. You know, ideally we can say, well, nothing in the movie matters, so I'm not even need to consider that at all. Well, that would be a position of one who already has accepted the overlay, okay, chosen a new idea, and therefore truly, and perfectly comfortable with it. Then, to them, it truly does not matter what happens at all. It doesn't affect their experiencing one bit. The entire universe could disappear and it wouldn't change their experiencing one bit. Not even one bit, because they're experiencing the overlay of all this. And the overlay can literally maintain an image of the entire thing that it's overlaying. And so if belief wants to destroy the universe, the overlay can still have this be a perfect universe being overlaid there. You know, it does not concern the dance of this movie of belief does not concern the overlay at all. It's not threatened by it. But we have not yet chosen a new idea. We have are not yet experiencing the overlay, and we're not perfectly familiar with it, therefore, of course. So our willingness to accept what is fragile and can vacillate. So it is highly relevant to us what kind of situation we're in. It's highly relevant. The ambassadors of truth tell us that our companions, our friends, our situations are highly relevant to us because we're vacillating, and if we get with bad company, we're going to get pulled down. If we get with good company, we're going to be elevated towards accepting what is, choosing a new idea. So we actually, we're the ones where it's most relevant. Most relevant. Those who are going along with belief, they're just trying to change what is. And so they're going to go through all these changes and traumas, etc. But to those who are trying to accept what is and choose a new idea that accepts what is, it's super relevant where they are, who their friends are, what the company they keep is, where their attention is. That becomes highly relevant, because they're making this transition from trying to change what is to accepting what is. And that's an uncertain transition, you know. There's a lot of fear involved with it, because if we choose to accept what is, we're afraid that belief will find some way to change it, and then we'll get annihilated, you know. There is that underlying concern. So it is highly relevant for those who are engaged in this gravitation, and a somewhat fragile gravitation. It is highly relevant to discuss these matters of remodeling, and what kind of remodel is it, and what kind of situation can we get into that optimizes our willingness to gravitate towards choosing a new idea and accepting what is. It's highly relevant. You have teachers like Muji, for instance, who's already gravitated towards what would be a live-in remodel off in the wilds of Portugal, living off the grid pretty much, and setting up a retreat there. You see, that would be anticipating a live-in remodel, gravitated out of London, the heart of London, to the backwoods of Portugal. That's a live-in remodel. Or it could be a live-in remodel, and then a relocation remodel is also possible. So you already have that example of someone who is, in my opinion, is in that getting used to the isness, accepting what is getting more and more comfortable with it. That is what I see with Muji's, getting more and more comfortable with that, has already, you know, chosen to go in that direction and gravitated towards that, and is getting more and more comfortable with it. So, obviously, Muji has seen a relevance to changing location and optimizing the situation that he's in, and those who will come to see him has already done that, you see. So that should be an indication. You'd say, aha, because that's one of those on this planet that has gravitated towards accepting what is, you see. More so than most. I don't see Muji as an ambassador of certainty, a perfect, flawless ambassador of certainty that, you know, on the level, like, for instance, a Ramana or Ananda Mahima, not yet, but gravitating towards that, you see. Well, certainly, at some point, we'll get to that, where it's completely effortless and seamless, no possibility of it being otherwise, and absolutely seeing nothing but the overlay, and it's, you know, it's could never be anything other than that, you know, the 100% flawless certainty kind of thing, gravitating towards that. Okay, gravitating towards that. One of those who is far along towards that, and there are others that may be far along towards that as well on this planet. And so if they're setting up a live-in remodel situation, that doesn't mean that they won't relocate at some time also. That should alert you to something, that changes are coming. That belief is going to, one, it's going to be, the remodel could be quite severe, and two, the importance of those who are gravitating toward accepting what is to get into a situation that optimizes that and protects them from this insane belief in remodeling that is possible to change what is, to get away from that. So I am praying for myself to be put into a better situation, to be put in an optimal situation. We really have the right, those of us who are gravitating to accepting what is, absolutely have the right and deserve an optimal situation. 100% deserve that. Now, it doesn't necessarily have to be a backwoods situation. I'm not a backwoods person. I've never liked being a backwoods person at all. I'm not a live off the land kind of person. Not at all. You don't have to be a survivalist. That is not necessarily necessary. Some thrive in that kind of situation. They love it. They love being self-sufficient, you know, being able to plant their own trees in their own gardens and generate, you know, use solar to generate their own electricity, have all these transformers and generators that run off electricity, and they're, you know, they have their own electrical grid, they have their own, you know, recycling, everything. They're trying to live off the grid entirely, kind of thing. For me, I'd be more interested in simply manifesting whatever is needed. You know, I'd rather live in a palace, so to speak, but being able to simply manifest whatever is needed. I mean, the fact is, if you want food, the truth is that you can simply manifest that. You know, people don't use that here very often, but it's absolutely, you can do that. An ambassador of certainty, of reality, they can literally manifest anything at all here, anything. They can manifest a palace. They can manifest billions of palaces. They can manifest an orchard, orange trees. They can manifest food. Can do anything like that. Just thought forms. Just imagination. I mean, thought forms. Whatever is necessary can simply arise like that. Time is not necessary. Process is not necessary. That's belief. Believes in time and process because it's trying to change what is. So what is trying to change what is has to work within process and time because it can't accomplish it. So it has to say it's on the road, on the path to accomplishment. Whereas what it accepts what is doesn't need any time or process for anything to happen. So it can be instantaneous. Cars can just drive. You know, you don't need anything. You don't even need energy for it to happen. But if you need a full tank of gas, you can just have a full tank of gas. That is a fact. That's another way to do it. You know, there's the survivalist way, the backwoods way, and there's also just the manifest way, just to manifest it. To go in that direction of just manifestation. And we say, well, we can't do that. Yeah, but an ambassador of certainty can do that. What we truly are, those who have accepted what is, can most certainly do that. Can most certainly manifest anything at all. No limits whatsoever. And I've always trended towards that. I've always trended in that direction. I just say, wow, why do I need to go through all this process? It's crazy. I hate process. I hate time and process. I said, this is ridiculous. Why not just manifest it? You know, because belief cannot do that, cannot work that way. It has to have a process to believe in. It has to have time. You know, it took time to do it. Belief cannot accept manifestation at all. It says, no, what is the process? I say, no process at all. Belief says, no, I can't believe in no process. Right? It can't believe in what is. And because reality is instantaneous. There's no gap. There's no process. There's no time. That is reality. And belief cannot believe in reality. So it can't believe in instantaneous manifestation. It cannot. So it won't accept that. It says, no, I got to be a survivalist. I got to live off, you know, I've got to, you know, work with energy. I've got to have processes involved. No, I don't feel like I need any process involved. And those who trend in that direction probably will trend towards either a live-in remodel or a relocation remodel, simply more based on manifestation, going in that direction. Like I've always felt that way. I want a tree. Why do I need to plant a tree? You know, I can't understand it at all. If I want a tree should simply be there like that. If I want food, it should just be there like that. And it's like this, I look at this world, this belief system, like this place is completely crazy. You should just be able to manifest whatever you want. What is this process? You know, it's nuts. Completely insane. So don't have this ethic of living off the land, you know, and survivalism. Don't have that, you know. I'm not like a hunter and a fisher. You know, I'm not gonna go out and hunt and fish and you know, chop wood and everything. If I want to feel warm, I should just feel warm. If I want to feel nourished, I should just feel nourished. You know, don't even need food, really. You just choose the feeling of being nourished. Choose that experience of being nourished. You're nourished. Choose the experience of being warm. You're warm. Choose the experience of having trees. There's the trees. It's like that. And you don't even need any technique at all, basically. And that is what, you know, a teacher of ambassador of truth, that's how they function here. They can also function within time and belief, make it seem like it, you know, takes time, etc. Doesn't have to, though. Doesn't have to. Someone once, there's a train leaving, and Ananda Mahima was on the platform, and someone said, reached to give her a hand to lift her up on the train, and they pulled her hand, and they were completely shocked because she had no weight at all. It was light as a feather. And there are times like when she had to lift stuff that was like super heavy, and just lift it like had no weight at all. And people were like stunned. They said, how can a little person like you lift all this super heavy stuff and do it like boom, 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 boom? It's like it was weightless, you know. Because for her, it had no weight. It had no weight. The laws of process, the laws of energies, the laws of belief do not apply to reality at all. Another thing was that they would have these huge feasts, religious pujas and feasts and celebrations, and there'd be so many people, and they'd just have a little bit of food to start with. And everyone would say, who was in charge of feeding everybody, they'd say, you know, we're in big trouble. We don't have anywhere close to the amount of food that we're supposed to have. We're supposed to label the rice and the vegetable dishes out. 1 second, somebody's coming here. I've got to go on a hold on this. Okay for now. And what would happen was they would say, we're going to run out, and more and more people would come. And what happened was they never ran out. They just keep passing out, and somehow they always had enough. How did that happen? No one could ever explain it. So, you see, that is how it works. You know, Jesus also, the multiplying of the loaves of bread and the fish, it's the same thing. Any ambassador of reality can, that's what happens. They never run out of food. Never. They never run out of anything that is necessary. There's no such thing as obstacles to them here. Because whatever they needs to be is like that. And yet they don't overuse that at all, because their only purpose is, I guess, to help us, you know, to help those who are gravitating towards accepting what is. They're not here to put on a show, you know. They're not trying to put on some grandiose show, you know, look at me, I can multiply, I can manifest everything, you know. No. They're very aware of you know, when does that get used? Because it would only frighten the dreamers, you know. It would only belief would say, okay, I got to do that. How do I do that? What's the process? And people become obsessed with trying to discover the process of manifestation. There is no, the answer is there is no process to it. And again, belief is obsessed with finding out the process of reality. So it can attack it. We think, we assume that belief is doing this to help us. No, 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 no. Belief is trying to figure out the process of reality so it can destroy it. Okay? Again, it's all this study of the universe. We assume the universe is the work of the prime creator, work of reality. It is not. It is the movie of belief. And so belief is studying the universe very careful. It believes it's studying the work of God, the work of the prime creator, the work of reality. It is not. And it's trying to figure out the process of it all so it can attack this process. It's just complete waste of time. It's like studying a dream, trying to figure out the process of a dream. You know, there's no point to it. This, all this stuff, this universe, the process of the universe is just a movie that belief is producing. So why? Belief is just studying belief. Belief is just studying belief. Finding out all this processes of energy. There's, reality is not energy based. There's no processes of energy in reality. Reality is essence based, a direct experiencing, instantaneous, spontaneous, expansive, direct experiencing. There's no energy at all. There's no process at all. There's no process to reality. And so if there's manifesting here, you know, belief will say, ah, oh, I got to find out how that happened. What's the process? And start, you know, there's some psychic thing, you know, and we'll get obsessed with, you know, psychic powers. How do we do this? No, it's just, it's spontaneous. No process involved. The more we believe in process, the more deluded we are. The more we're accepting, engaging with belief, wanting belief to be true. Right? For me, like I have no interest in process. You know, I can't make any machine or tool or anything like that, because I just have no desire for or love of process whatsoever. I couldn't tell you how anything works really. If it was up to me, you know, can you make tools, machines? No way. Couldn't do it. I just have no interest at all in process or how things work or how energy works. No interest in energy, no interest in process. Just, you know, complete apathy towards it. Just tune it out and no interest in it. You know, pragmatically, I have to, you know, just to live here, you have to function here. It's very difficult, though. And people expect me to fix stuff. You know, say, oh, you're so smart. You should be able to fix stuff. I have no interest in fixing stuff or anything. I'm not good at fixing anything. You have to do stuff in the world, but I have no interest in it. It doesn't engage me at all. I'm trying to adjust it. The light keeps changing here. Everything keeps changing here. You know, if I figure out how to do these videos because it's a desire to share and help in this world to gravitate toward accepting what is. That's so I'm able to do this because that is my intent, is to help in this way. But it's not like it comes easy, or that I want to keep engaging in it, you know, forever or anything like that. And it's just simply, you know, this helps the purpose, so I'll do it. So we're really pushing things forward here in this video, you know, has expanded. It's always expanded the scope, expanded the intensity, getting the situation more and more on track and up to speed, giving you more and more tools that you can use. Just use, is this a live-in remodel or a relocation remodel? what kind of relocation I'm looking for. Is it a survivalist backwards thing, or more towards a manifestation kind of thing? Those are some more tools. Recognizing that the goal is to simply accept what is, whereas belief is sponsoring all the spirituality of trying to transcendence, enlightenment, changing what is, recognizing the difference, you know, the recognizing the fragility of gravitating towards accepting what is, and how it's super important. Those who are doing that have every right and to deserve help in this world, to be put in the right place and right circumstances that will help that. They have every right, totally deserve it, and should not be held back from that under any circumstances. To those who want to keep watching this movie, you know, they're free to do that. We don't want to, you know, to change what is, and yet we need to be focused on the overlay of this movie, and put in circumstances that help us do that. So there's all these factors that are super relevant for us, and I believe this. I know this video has done that. We have these customs of speech to say, I believe, you know, because we're so used to belief. We need to get to knowing. You know, I know this video has addressed these issues quite well. I know it. It's a fact. Don't have to say, I believe it. No. I know it. It is true. So we are, counting down now towards this very consequential election, in that there's going to be turmoil after it, no matter what happens. There's going to be just a feeling of, this is it, you know. We don't have what we want. Change is coming. Remodeling is coming. It's going to come one way or the other, isn't it? Drastically. And it's going to be more drastic than we can acknowledge at this point. Everything has already been downsized. All the cuts have already been made. You know, there's no more cuts to be made. I mean, we've already dug into the situation so much. It is simply a question of, where is the remodeling going to happen first? Okay, that is really the question. The remodel is going to happen. The question is, you know, is it going to be the bathroom first, or the kitchen first, or the dining room first? Is it, you know, those are the only questions, really. Where is the remodeling going to happen first? But it's going to be a drastic remodel, and probably a knockdown remodel. Ultimately, you know, it's going to be a knockdown remodel, from what I've seen. We may play at, you know, partial remodels first, and we may play at a live-in remodel for a while. Okay, maybe that, a live-in remodel for a while, but then we realize, you know, this is going to be a knockdown remodel. So it's going to be a relocation remodel, because it's going to be a knockdown. And we may, you know, have to do that. There's not many people who can accept that it's going to be a knockdown remodel at this point. So first we may say, okay, live-in remodel. But, you know, where does the remodel start? That is the question right now. The election is all about, where does the remodel start? That's what it's about. It's not about whether there will be a remodel or not. No, there is going to be a remodel. The United States is bankrupt. And, you know, the speculation and all the positions I've been taking with computers, speculating on the future, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, has meant that right now, these present times, the floor is going to drop out. It's going to collapse. And there's already all the speculation in the future of positioning in the future of those who are trying to decide that they, you know, they're going to be saved from this remodel, so to speak, and the remodel is going to happen to someone else. That's what's been happening. You know, if you wonder, what are all those people, traders and speculators and on computers, high super fast systems, what are they doing? They're trying to position themselves so the remodel doesn't happen to them, happens to someone else. But of course, they are not gravitating towards accepting what is. They're just trying to get at, trying to avoid the remodel, but still, you know, be the those in power within belief. Okay, so they're looking for a good situation for themselves. But those who want to accept what is, they deserve an optimal situation for their purpose, which is truly divine, which is truly holy, which is truly supported by reality. And so they have a right to be in a very good situations, but not based on, you know, they're not speculating. I'm not doing any speculating in the markets or anything like that at all. I have 0 cents invested in anything. Okay, so it's very different. Speculators are, again, trying to get all the money, all the power, whatever they can get for the future, and then realizing the collapse is coming, but they don't want it to come hit them. See? So that is increasing more and more and more and more. You have this massive speculations and positions in the future, because they know, those in the know the collapse is coming. They know it. And they're just trying to escape it, avoid it, avoid the remodel, live and remodel for them, for themselves. But they're not really positioning themselves for a relocation remodel, you know. So they're coming up short. They're shorting themselves that way. And so the battle is over who is going to bear the brunt of this early remodel that's happening, you know. Whoever's in charge of the government, in charge of this stuff, will have their favorite sons and daughters, you know. And they'll say, look, we're going to take from this one sector and give to this other sector. And they're going to not bear the brunt of the remodel. And it's those other bad, guilty people who are going to bear the brunt of the remodel, you see. And there's very differing ideologies in this election of who's going to bear the brunt of the remodel. And they both say, oh, the middle class is going to be protected. You know, nonsense. No. That is not how it's working at all. That's how to get elected, but that is not their intentions at all. Both of them are actually going to sacrifice the middle class. Both, no matter who gets elected, the middle class is going to be sacrificed. And one is going to give to the entitlement class, or the class that, you know, who live on handouts. The other is going to give more towards those who are super industrious, business, upper middle class, upper class, elite types, saying that they're entitled to not bear the brunt because they're the ones who work so hard. The others say that the poor people get all the handouts. They never had a chance. They didn't get the opportunity, so they deserve to not bear the handouts. They deserve to not bear the brunt of it. But in either case, it's the middle class that gets hammered. Either case. And being a middle class myself, I know that very well, that the trend is unmistakable. I talk to middle class people all the time, middle class business people, and they say we are getting hammered, that we are going to get extinguished the way things are going. That is a fact. But of course, in the election, both candidates are pandering to the middle class, saying, I'm all for you. That is a complete mistruth. The middle class is just going to get absolutely hammered, no matter what happens. And the middle class knows that, you know. And so they're not happy with either candidate, really. And each candidate is trying to, you know, it's a beauty contest is what it is. It's a beauty contest trying to say, oh no, we're all for you, and the other one hates you, you know. No. So there will be turmoil, there will be remodeling, there will be those who bear the brunt of this remodel. And, you know, being middle class has been the perfect position for me, because I could feel it all coming. You feel it all coming. When you're in the crosshairs, you feel it coming. I'm not getting any handouts from the government at all. And I don't believe in that at all. But on the same hand, I'm not a business person who's, you know, has the capability to earn a bunch of money either. I'm not that way at all either. So you can feel in that position, it has all this stuff happening. Realize you're having the rug pulled out from underneath you. You're either a super go-getter or you're super talented at manipulating the system and taking other people's money, as far as handouts go. And if you're not either one of those, you're going to be up a creek coming up. We're going to be up a creek. You either are super good at generating a bunch of income for yourself, or you're super good at stealing the income that those who do generate income from themselves generate, you know, under laws and, you know, super high taxation and all sorts of ways to take what those who are super good at generating income, there's all sorts of ways to take it away from them. So if you're either one or the other, or if you're not either of those, you're going to get hammered in the future here. You're going to get hammered. You're going to bear the brunt of the remodel. That's a fact. And so being aware of that, I'm super aware, like, hey, some sort of relocation is essential. It's essential for the middle class, absolutely. Most of those who are really in tune with what's being said here are from the middle class because they've known for a long time they're in the crosshairs of history. It's been obvious. And some are desperately trying to get into the entitlement class of generating a lot of wealth for themselves. And there are others who have been desperately trying to get into the handout class who are generating ways to steal all that wealth, redistribute it, quote unquote. And there are others who say, no, I don't want to do either one of those, who find themselves then on the true spiritual path of moving towards accepting and choosing a new idea and getting the grace of God to be helped by the grace of God, by the grace of this accepting what is. All we need to do is simply be willing to accept what is. And what is? Reality is. Perfection is. And perfect inclusion is. Identity is. Flawless, spontaneous, direct experiencing is. Endless expansion is. And even this belief system is. But it can't change what is, you see. So it's really nothing, you know, it doesn't have any effect on reality. We don't have to change this belief system at all. It's just a silly whim to change what is that has no effect whatsoever. But that still is, right? We don't have to change it. So those that are going towards that, many who realize they're in the crosshairs of this remodel, they're going to get knocked down first. Eventually, the whole thing is going to get knocked down. But first to get knocked down is the middle class will get knocked down. And so those are the ones who generally have been most intense on this spiritual path, the true path of accepting what is. Those are the ones that deserve the grace of God. And the grace of God is unlimited. It is unlimited. Literally, the grace of God can literally manifest an entire planet. A beautiful, beautiful planet like that, instantly. That is a fact. There is no limits to what the grace of God can manifest. None. And if we are capable of accepting that, we literally could relocate to such a place. That is possible. Or there could be some place on this planet to relocate to. All these options are on the table, and we need to realize they're on the table. Because the hammering of the middle class is going to come very soon. Very, very soon. It's going to take a while for the others to be hammered down because those who have generated massive wealth, you know, are going to try to hold on to it as much as possible, those who have wealth. And those who are used to stealing this wealth, taking it, redistributing it, they have all sorts of channels and ways and means that are already in place to do this for themselves. And they know how to work the system very well already. And it'll take a while to change that system. For instance, if the wealthy get in power, it'll take a while. So, but right off the bat, the middle class are going to get hammered. And then either the redistributionists will get hammered or the elite or the super wealthy will get hammered, one of the two. But eventually the whole thing will collapse. So actually the middle class is ahead of the game right now, and they can choose relocation actually, either on this planet or somewhere else, something that's manifested. They can choose that. They can choose to allow the grace of God to put them in optimal situations. And then they can help the others who are going to get hammered down the road, for sure. They're going to get hammered down the road. Because as I say, this is really what's coming as a knockdown remodel. It's really going to be a knockdown remodel completely. Foundation is even going to be knocked down. So there will be a need to help those who are as of yet, you know, still thinking they can win. You know, they're not going to get remodeled. The elitists, the super wealthy, those who have a lot of money and wealth and capital, etc., they believe they can win. And those who want to redistribute that and take it all for themselves, they believe they can do that. So they're not thinking about what we're thinking about. They're not considering what we're considering. They think they can gain the system and win, and that the remodel won't affect them. And they're delusional. They're delusional. If you're on the path of accepting what is, you've been clued into what's going to happen in this world. And actually, it is going to be a knockdown remodel eventually at some point. I'm not sure about the timing on it, but it's not important, the timing. It's coming soon. And so these issues of optimizing your situation are super important. The issue of the grace of God, the grace of reality, is super important. The issue of accepting optimal conditions for yourself is super important. Okay, so these videos are super important. Otherwise, I wouldn't be using my time this way. I'd be doing something else. And the light, there's clouds today, and so the lighting keeps changing. I have to keep changing this, changing. So we're just, this is real. This is getting, keeping it real. We had a saying in the 60s, you gotta keep it real. Gotta keep it real. We were rebelling against everything then, especially the educational system, which was just turning us into robots, you know, which sprang out of the Industrial Revolution and the idea that we're all just parts of some machine. And we rebelled against that. We rebelled against the authority, you know, the corporations, you know, and we said we got to keep it real, meaning we got to talk about what is really happening. Because if we're not talking about what was really happening, we're not keeping it real. And we're talking about what's really happening here. So that's keeping it real. Because the remodeling is going to happen. It's just a question of where does it happen first, and it's going to start happening very soon. Very, very soon. And the elites are not the only ones who will have safe enclaves. Those who are gravitating towards accepting what is will also have enclaves for themselves. Just like when the Roman Empire collapsed, those who are gravitating towards accepting what is, they had their enclaves. They had their monasteries. They had their spiritual retreats. They were well taken care of. The grace of God does take care of those who are gravitating towards accepting what is. Absolutely. But they're not in the same category as the elites who just are trying to hoard, you know, keep their wealth that they've generated through being very shrewd and industrious. Most of them. Some of them have been vicious too, but let's not kid ourselves. I know business people. They're very smart. They're very capable. They work very hard. They make very smart decisions. They're super smart. Boom, 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 boom. You know, they're capable. Very capable people. Let us not perpetuate this myth that somehow they're just stealing everything, you know. I mean, that has more to do with the speculators who are also super smart. But there's a lot of prosperous business people who are just very capable. Very ingenious, very inventive, very clever. Managing people. They know how to manage people and give people jobs, you know. Very good at it. And so they have their enclaves. You know, they do. They have their enclaves. They've been working on it for a long time. But it's not the same as the enclaves of those who are on the true spiritual path to accepting what is. They also should deserve their enclaves too. And the enclaves can be even better. More peaceful, more beautiful. Absolutely. And those who want to fight it out, of course, they're not going to have those enclaves, you know. Those who want to hoard everything or want to steal everything for themselves. They don't want to work, they don't want to do anything. They just want to take. You know, they will fight it out. Because they're trying to establish, you know, some super enclave, and they want to fight to win. Whereas those who want to accept what is say, no, we'll just accept what the grace of God gives to us or manifests for us. We're not going to fight anything out. We're not going to fight for any outcome. We'll just pray to be guided to to what is, to what is made available to us, and be grateful for it. So that's where we're at right now. We're at the most incredible time on this planet has ever had. This is a fact. The times we're in right now are the most incredible times that this planet has ever experienced. Nothing comes close. Not even comes close. Immeasurably more. And so we should expect immeasurably more of God's grace, the grace of reality, if you want to put it that way, the grace of reality. We should expect immeasurably more grace of reality to benefit us, to give us optimal conditions so that we can continue our gravitation towards accepting, simply accepting what is. And not getting caught up in this battle royal, which is coming between the wealthy, the elites, and those who want to redistribute all this wealth to themselves. they say they want to redistribute it to the middle class. That is nonsense. They want to redistribute it to themselves. Middle class, the redistribution doesn't generate wealth. Middle class works. The wealthy generate jobs and people work, and there's a flow there. When you just simply take from the wealthy and just redistribute it to the poor, there's no flow there. There's no flow. There's no sustaining of that. It's not a sustaining. It's not a healthy economy, you see. So the redistribution, they want to just take it, take it. It's not sustainable. It doesn't sustain. It's not healthy. And of course, the wealthy, super wealthy, they also want to just take everything for themselves and become, super wealthy and just have these super enclaves, and they want to do that too. And that's not healthy either for the economy. It's not. The middle class is what is healthy for the economy, actually. Growing the middle class is what's healthy. But both sides say, oh no, we're all for growing the middle class, where in truth they're not for that at all. Therefore, they just want to completely rob from the middle class and leave nothing but a corpse for themselves. They want to have everything for themselves. So we're headed towards, disaster. Economic disaster. Which we don't deserve to go through at all. If we see the remodel coming, we say, okay, we want to gravitate towards accepting what is. We deserve then optimal conditions to help us do that. And we don't have to be bothered, disturbed by this remodel that's taking place. It has no relevance to us at all, because we're not looking for any outcome in this dance of existence. We're not looking for any outcome. We're looking simply to accept it as it is, accept what is, and to experience this isness, this acceptance of no effort to try to generate outcomes or change what is. So it's not our battle. It's not our remodel. And yet we deserve optimum conditions to realize it is not our battle. It is not our remodel. We deserve it. Expect it. We are entitled to that, truly entitled to that. Optimal conditions for that. Reality entitles us to it. What we are entitled is to us, because we're not looking for any outcome. So that truly puts us in a position of genuine entitlement for optimal conditions, because that is what will trickle down to everyone else and help everybody else to eventually accept what is instead of trying to change what is. There you go. There it is. That's keeping it real. All right. That's it for this video. Very great.